but in this case, I want to perform at the end a 20-minute piano suite that he composed when he was still a young man. So there's going to be some changing of the chronology, but I hope you'll be able to follow any. So the first thing you ask when you hear about a composer named Mario Castelnuovo-Tedesco, I'm sure you're wondering about the name, because it's quite a long, complicated, and hyphenated name. So I'm going to explain that first. So this man was able to trace his heritage back many hundreds of years, even before the Spanish Inquisition. He was from a Jewish family in Spain, and their original name was Castelnuovo, which translates as Old Castle. And there are still some towns in Spain with that same name. But in the Spanish Inquisition, many Jewish families who were not murdered, they were able to leave. They escaped sometimes to Italy, and that was the case in his ancestors. And they kept the same name, Castelnuovo, in Italian becomes Castelnuovo, which still means New Castle. So then the question is, what about the Tedesco part? Well, the grandfather of Mario was named Angiolo. You always have to do this when you speak Italian. Angiolo had a business partner who actually married his aunt, Angiolo's aunt. And that man's name was Samuel Tedesco, which literally, the word Tedesco in Italian means German, so he was Mr. German. So Mr. and Mrs. Samuel Tedesco were a very wealthy couple, but they didn't have any children or heirs. So he made an agreement with Mario's grandfather that when he dies, when they both die, the inheritance would go directly to Angiolo's family, provided that he somehow links on the name Tedesco, so at least the name would live on. And that's what they agreed upon, and that's what they did. So he became Angiolo Castelnuovo Tedesco. I hope you're following that, because there'll be a short quiz at the end. Here's a photo of Mario as a young boy, and here he is grown up. And here's another photographic portrait of him in later years. Now, early in his career in Italy, he's from Florence, he developed a strong interest in literary works, especially those of Shakespeare. And during his career, he actually wrote overtures and sometimes incidental music to all of these Shakespeare plays. He also had a strong interest in the early years in opera. And again, you see Shakespeare is well represented. As I mentioned, he was from a Jewish family, so he also had a strong interest in Jewish liturgy and the Bible. And at various points in his life, he wrote these works. The first two are for solo piano, by the way, Dance of King David, Stories of Joseph. Ruth and Naomi is an oratorio, which is recorded. And a few other works. In the 1930s, still in Italy, he met Andre Segovia and was very inspired by his playing and decided to start writing works for Segovia. Even though Castelnuovo Tedesco himself did not play guitar, it wasn't a problem because, as in the case of Manuel Ponce, these composers would write and then send the music to Segovia, who would then make corrections. Oh, you can't possibly do that, you know. So they'd have a correspondence or actually in-person conversation about it. And I just wanted to play an excerpt of the guitar concerto he wrote while he was still living in Italy. And again, keep in mind the Spanish, it was somehow in his ancestry, the Spanish music as well as Italian music. And you can certainly hear the feeling of Spanish. Let me jump to the third. Third movement. Castelnuovo-Tedesco and his family were able to get exit visas. In 1939, they immigrated to the USA. And it was certainly with the help of very high-level first-class musicians, which he had met along the way, including Yasha Heifetz and Toscanini, who had helped secure invitations and even promises of work in New York and Hollywood. So this began the second half of his life. He became a film composer and became quite good at it. He wrote for nearly 200 films. Many of them are undocumented. In other words, it doesn't have his name when you watch the film, but that was the nature of the work. It was like that. I just want to give you a few examples of the films he wrote for. Lassie Come Home, this was, as you know, the first of a long series of Lassie movies. The first six, you don't have to really know this, but I'll tell you since I happen to know it. The first six Lassie movies were made with the same dog whose name in real life was Pal. So this was Lassie Come Home, 1943, scored by Mario Castelnuovo-Tedesco. Spoiler alert, Lassie comes home. Return of the Vampire, 1944. As you see, it does feature Bela Lugosi, who you will remember in 1931, he had made the big hit about Dracula. So you're probably wondering why this sequel was not named Return of Dracula. It's because it was made by a different film company. This one is in Columbia, where the previous one was in Universal. So they weren't allowed to use the word Dracula, but it certainly was Dracula. Another example, I Love a Mystery, 1945. And there have been several film versions of A Picture of Dorian Gray. This particular one, which Castelnuovo-Tedesco wrote for, was 1945. And I have a little clip. It's actually the trailer, the preview of Coming Attractions. And even though there's a lot of talking, try to listen to the musical score underneath.
Be always what I am now. For that I would give everything. There's nothing in the whole world I would not give. I would give my soul for that.
The vain jealousy which prompted Dorian Gray to utter this fateful prayer was destined to sweep him into a life so fraught with vice and evil that its marks became horrible to behold. For the mad wish of Dorian Gray was granted through some supernatural miracle. And day by day, he watched his sins etch themselves upon his painted portrait, while he himself stayed young and handsome. Every vile thought and act, every criminal deed, left its mark upon the painted canvas that was to bear the burden of his shame. Down to depths of degradation frightful to conceive went Dorian Gray, seeking new outlets to satisfy his passion for pleasure. His extraordinary visits into the strange world of crime and sin became notorious. And when he reappeared again in society, men would whisper to each other in corners or look at him with searching eyes. Women, who for his sake had set convention at defiance, were seen to grow pale if Dorian Gray entered the room. What was this strange fascination this man held for everybody? To what limits of evil did he drag those he knew? Men and women alike, all fell under the spell of his charm, and yet to know him was to court shame and disaster.
Thank you. going, little soldier, because wherever it is, I'm going with you.
Flying saucers have invaded our planet. Washington, London, Paris, Moscow are key targets. The whole world is under attack. Can it survive?
Survivors of a disintegrated solar system. At this moment, the remainder of our fleet is circling your globe.
What do you want with me?
Arrange for your world leaders to confer with us in the city of Washington.
You set up an electronic screen. The artillery doesn't penetrate.
Never before has the screen reached such heights of excitement. Breathtaking spectacle. Hair-raising terror. See the saucer men's high-frequency disintegrator. See flying saucers travel thousands of miles in seconds. See great cities leveled by flying saucer monsters.
Russ, look.
The same kind of thing that's watched us since the beginning of the project.
People of Earth, attention. People of Earth, attention. This is a voice speaking to you from thousands of miles beyond your planet.
They're coming down to take over. They made that clear to us in the saucer.
To the best of our knowledge, my wife and I are the only ones left alive.
Spoiler alert on that one. The Earth survived. So, Castelnuovo-Tedesco had arrived around 1940 in Hollywood, and as you see, had a big and long career writing for films. But he also had a lot of students there. I just want to mention a few. The first one was a cantor in a synagogue who later moved to Baltimore, and actually I knew him and his whole family. This was cantor Abraham Salpo. And he studied, and he himself wrote a lot of liturgical music for Jewish services. Now, some of the film composers included who studied with Castelnuovo-Tedesco included people you do know, such as Henry Mancini, Nelson Riddle, wrote the original Batman music, John Williams, who's still very active today, of course, and Jerry Goldsmith, Alien. Also, Andre Previn. In this case, I'm showing you an example of an opera he wrote based on The Streetcar Named Desire. Now, the work that I want to perform is from 1924. Castelnuovo-Tedesco had just gotten married, and he and his wife, Clara, were on their honeymoon. They were planning to go to the Amalfi Coast, one of the most beautiful areas of Italy. It's on the western coast, but it was terrible weather and lots of rainstorm, so instead they went to Naples. And during that time, 1900s, there was a songwriting competition associated with the festival. And a lot of songs that you do know, like Finiculi, Finicula, and O Sole Mio, were written specially for that songwriting competition, and they've become very well known. The tunes in this particular suite are not as well known, but I will let you hear a recording of one of them before I play. This is the only photo I could find of the young Clara and Mario together, and there you see the first of their little sons, that's Pietro. And I wanted to mention that Walter Gieseking, in those early years in the 1920s, was a close friend of Castelnuovo-Tedesco, and he had come for a concert to play in Florence, and he was visiting, and he saw a new score on the piano, which was the piece I'm going to play, and he said, oh, what's this? And he started playing like perfectly, like just sight reading the whole thing, and Gieseking asked him, oh, do you want me to play this tomorrow night at my concert? He said, no, you should see Florence. Don't worry about learning a new piece in one day. But he learned it in 5 days and then later gave the premiere in Berlin. Now, here's a picture of the church in Naples that I mentioned. This is the Santa Maria di Piedigrotta. And that's where the festival and march parade, ends at that church. Now, there are five movements. The first one is Tarantella Scura. Tarantella, as you know, is an Italian dance in 6/8. And you probably realize that the word tarantella is very close to tarantula. And if you look up historically, you see tarantulas are mentioned many times in the past having to do with music. Why cannot those poisoned by tarantulas be cured otherwise by music? Because the fact is, when you're bitten by a tarantula, if you keep moving, if you keep dancing, you don't let the poison like settle into your organs, then you'll survive. That was the legend. Maybe it still is, I don't know. So keep that in mind when I perform the tarantella. The second movement, Night of Moonlight, Notte Luna. This is a completely different mood. It's very nocturne-like, and the melody seems to float weightlessly above the earth. And some of the texture will remind you of works of the Spanish composers Granados and Albéniz. That's the Night of Moonlight. The middle movement is the most lighthearted, Calascionate. This is based on an instrument that's not used very often anymore. It resembles a lute, but with extremely long neck. Here's a historical picture of an actual calosione. And here's a more contemporary picture of that instrument. It's usually with three strings and plays open fifths and fourths. So that is the name of the third movement. And some other images of people having fun in the old days. And the fourth movement is the one based on an actual Neapolitan folk song called Finestra che Lucive, The Light in the Window. And a story of it is a man who's returning after a long time to the home of his beloved, and he doesn't see her. He sees the light is on, but suddenly her sister leans out and tells the man that she died and she's in the graveyard at the church. Quote, she always cried when she slept alone, but now she sleeps with death. He will never walk down that street again. Instead, he will walk in the cemetery and await the day that death allows him to be with his sweetheart again. During the melody in the piano, Castelnuovo-Tedesco adds a rather unexpected, very otherworldly secondary melody, which eventually takes over the whole movement and becomes a secondary melody in addition to the original folk song. And at the end, when you hear me do the glissando, very gentle glissando and black notes, you writes in the score, come una stella cadente, like a falling star. Here's an excerpt of Enrico Caruso singing this melody that you're going to hear. First light of dawn. And at the very end, you hear a little echo.